I'm James Pang, a research fellow at the Turner Institute for Brain and Mental Health at Monash University. I do neuroimaging and computational modeling to better understand the mechanisms of brain function in both health and disease and across species.
And my name is Alex Fornita. I'm a professor at the Turner Institute for Brain and Mental Health in the School of Psychological Sciences at Monash University. And my research uses brain imaging techniques like MRI to try to understand how the brain is organized, how it works in healthy people and people with psychiatric illnesses. Every thought, feeling, and behavior we have is associated with a specific pattern of activity in the brain. And for a long time, neuroscientists have thought that those patterns are driven by the way that signals move between different parts of the brain along a vast web of trillions of connecting fibers. And so we've thought for a long time that we would need to map all of that intricate connectivity to try in order to understand brain function. Our work suggests that that's not necessarily the case and that we can learn a lot about the way the brain works simply by studying the shape of the brain.
Every thought we have is associated with a specific pattern of activity in our brain. These patterns have long been thought to arise from signals communicated through a vast web of cellular connections. New research shows that the shape of the brain is just as important because it influences how waves of activity move through the brain, suggesting that it may be possible to predict the activity of the brain simply from its shape.
We've analysed 10,000 brain maps acquired using MRI to compare the effect of brain shape in explaining the activity patterns that these MRI maps provide. And what we found is that the constraint that brain shape provides is more fundamental than what the connectivity inside your brain provides.
Our work used the concept of an Eigen mode. So an Eigen mode is a preferred pattern or mode of excitation in an object or a system. So if you imagine a violin string, it will have certain preferred ways of vibrating. If I pluck the string, it will vibrate in some way. Those vibrations correspond to the sounds that we hear. And the Eigen modes of the string are the preferred ways in which the string likes to vibrate. And those are determined by the physical properties of the string, like its length and tension and so on. In a similar way, the brain has its own preferred patterns of excitation or Eigen modes, and they're determined by the anatomical properties of the brain. So, and our work in particular identified that the geometry or shape of the brain plays a really important role in determining what those preferred patterns of excitation are. The idea is that different modes will be excited by different types of information. So for example, if you see something or hear something. And one of the interesting findings of our work is that if we look across activity maps recorded as people performed over 10,000 different cognitive, emotional, sensory, and motor tasks, we find that all of those tasks tended to excite modes that vary over very coarse spatial scales or long wavelengths, spanning nearly the entire brain. And this challenges conventional approaches to brain mapping, where we've traditionally focused on trying to identify focal areas of the brain that show increased activity in response to particular types of stimuli.
So we draw inspiration from physics and engineering, because if you look at a pond, for example, the activity and the wave ripples inside that pond is governed by the shape of that pond. And so we draw this analogy to the brain. So we try and measure and capture how the shape of the brain could constrain a lot of the activity that happens underneath. So that's why we use shape and connectivity, because they're the two fundamental anatomical structures in the brain that could provide these constraining of brain function.
Our work raises the possibility that we can predict different patterns of activity purely from a model of the shape of the brain. And that has an immediate practical benefit, because it's much easier to get scans of brain shape than it is of brain function. And because everyone's brain shape is different, much like a fingerprint, it also suggests that differences in brain shape might be related to differences in the way we think about and experience the world. So that then tells us, if we understand how the shape of the brain develops, it might give us some insight into the mechanisms of risk for neurological and psychiatric disorders such as schizophrenia, depression, and dementia. We both have different backgrounds and perspectives. So I come from a neuroscience and psychology background. James comes from a physics background. We're able to bridge the language barriers of those two disciplines to try to come up with interesting questions and develop ways of testing those ideas. And I think that's worked really well between us.